That bombshell book rocking the White House.
They all say he is like a child. It's all about him.
So you stand by everything in the book, nothing made up?
Absolutely everything in the book.
Steve Bannon turning on the president and his family.
Mr. President, what do you say to Michael Wolff?
The White House has pushed back hard, calling it fiction.
It's absolutely outrageous to make these types of accusations.
The author is a garbage author of a garbage book.
If I left out anything, it's probably stuff that was even more damning.
It's that bad.
As Fire and Fury turns into a political firestorm, author Michael Wolff is standing by his controversial book about President Donald Trump and the inside operations of his White House. This morning, he sat down with me in New York for an exclusive Canadian television interview. Let's start with why a president and an Oval Office would give you this sort of access, because that's what kept going through my mind as I read it.
I mean, obviously, this has gone through my mind. So the answer is actually, I don't know. I think it's part of the utter disorganization of this White House, the fact that there was no plan. It literally is, if someone said to you, you're the president of the United States, what do you do now? They had no more background in this than you or I would have.
And then you ended up sitting there for like a year.
Well, from slightly less, from just after the inauguration until Bannon was pushed out of the White House in the end of August.
Right.
And then I went back several more times, but at the end of August, I began to write this book.
Yeah, so it's not, you never were in accountability interviews. You were soaking up conversations, listening for tone.
Exactly, and the book was, I thought, as I was thinking about the book, I thought it would be really great if I made the perspective for the reader to have an experience of sitting on this couch in the White House and letting it just pour over the reader's head as it poured over my head.
And you certainly did that. Although there are so many points throughout the book where I wonder how accurate is this. And by that I mean, is it a fictionalized version of what you saw?
It is absolutely in no way, shape, or form a fictionalized version. I mean, this is absolutely literally what I saw or what I heard.
But it's not, you were not present for all of those conversations. Some of those are things that people related back to.
Absolutely, as a piece of reporting, they would tell me this happened, and this happened. And at times there was some marked discrepancy between those accounts. So then you had to go and speak to another person. And sometimes in the book, I just let everybody talk and you judge for yourself.
So one of the things that you keep saying in interviews is that this book is not about your impressions of the White House, it's other people's impressions of the president. Let me give you what my takeaway was from the president. He seems at times sort of sad, lonely, desperate to be liked. In fact, Katie Walsh, one of his advisors, says at some point that he fundamentally needs to be liked so badly everything's a struggle for him. I mean, you paint that picture of him one night, or many, many nights, in his bed, eating hamburgers by himself, just calling people constantly. Is that what you expected? Is that the fellow that you knew?
This is not a surprise. Donald Trump, certainly when Donald Trump was elected and through the campaign, we knew that this was a different kind of person. And a person, he rather wears his issues, as it were, on his sleeve. But I think the thing was to look about how he adapted getting into this presidency. Listen, the presidency changes people. I think that there was no way to know what to expect of a Donald Trump presidency, and I was perfectly willing to encounter a surprise in the opposite direction. That he had risen to this, that his uniqueness changed the office in positive ways. I did not find that. I found, and I've heard this, people have commented this about the presidency before, is that it magnifies who you are in extreme ways. And I think that's what's happened here. The president's insecurities are magnified. The president's intellectual deficiencies are magnified. The president's own willingness to tolerate, actually perhaps willingness to create chaos, has been magnified. So this is the presidency, essentially, this becomes Donald Trump writ large.
You know, there didn't really seem to be an intent to win, or there was no desire to win.
I think it actually goes further, that there was a plan not to win, that losing got them everything that they would want. I mean, everybody would be elevated by losing here.
In terms of brand.
He'd be the most famous man in the world. He could do anything, would be bound by nothing. His children, socialites in Manhattan, would be global superstars. Steve Bannon would have gone on to be the absolute leader of the alt-right Tea Party. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Kellyanne Conway would have been a cable star.
News star, yeah.
By winning, however, everybody got exposed. They got exposed because they have no idea what they're doing. They got exposed because they didn't protect themselves. They were making deals all over the place. The Russians, the this, you know, that put them under the spotlight in such a way that they won't be able to escape that. Being a success means that they are accountable.
And so there is the suggestion by other people that he might be dyslexic, that his comprehension is limited. You call him post-literate. Does he not read anything?
He doesn't read anything.
No.
I mean, that's the thing. Everybody goes around saying he doesn't read anything. Occasionally, you know, sort of, and then there's the thing. Someone would say, well, he reads a headline. And then someone will say,
a tweet.
Somebody else will say, he only reads a headline if it's about him. So we're talking about this is an absolutely unique, exceptional situation. And you know, obviously it's more critical because if you're the president of the United States, it's really, the job may be just about taking in information.
Well, you give this one anecdote that was so striking to me around the Syria gas attack when nothing's getting through to him and finally his daughter comes in with pictures.
Right.
And it's the only thing that works.
Absolutely, and there's a whole set of strategies that everyone comes up with. How do we communicate with him? Part of the reason there's so many leaks in this White House is that one way to communicate with him is through the television. Mm-hmm. He does watch television, so you leak your position through to whatever show he can be counted on to watch.
How much do you think that leaking and the different camps that were happening, whether it be his family, Bannon, or Priebus, contributed to the chaos? If he had had more stability around him in terms of advisors, would it have been a different first year?
I think it comes from him. White Houses are staffed by people who are loyal to the president. They're loyal to the president because they have gone through a battle with him.
Right.
They've gone through campaigns that can be, you know, you can be talking 3 or 4 years. Longer. These are close relationships. Donald Trump goes into the presidency almost a year ago with people who he doesn't really know.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Nobody is close. I mean, Steve Bannon, who is really the most important figure, has only known him since the August before.
You seem to paint a very interesting portrait of Steve Bannon, more sympathetic than I would have thought. And he has lots of ideas that he tries to push. In fact, things that would have protected Trump, this whole setup, a communications war room outside of the White House to protect him from the Russia collusions. And that falls apart. But the fact that he is now gone, how do you think that has impacted Trump and the White House?
Well, I think it's not just that Steve is gone. It's everybody has gone.
Sure.
I mean, in most White Houses, you lose people, but you lose them at the end of the first term, not at the end of the first six months. And the really strange thing is that the people who are left, I mean, right now, the two senior advisors to the president in the White House, one is Hope Hicks, who's a former junior level fashion PR person. Mm-hmm. And the other is Stephen Miller, who got some notice over the weekend on a television performance that was as wackadoo as anything one has recently seen.
The president and the White House.
The reason why I want to talk about
the president and the White House.
The reason why I want to talk about.
This is preposterous. These are two people who in no way have the background, the experience, the maturity to be the two senior advisors.
Were you surprised that Bannon walked back on some of the things that he had said to you?
I think that he's just trying to figure out how to manage this and doesn't know. I mean, I think this did not play out as he had hoped.
Well, and now he's left Breitbart, and I wondered with that news yesterday, has he lost the battle?
I never say lose. I always thought his title, chief strategist, was the perfect title because that's what he is.
Yes.
He strategizes, and I would not count him out.
Is he dangerous?
I think he could bring Trump down, yes.
Was that part of the reason why I wanted to talk to you so often on the record?
Yes, I think my theory, and it's just a theory, is that he thought Roy Moore, the senator in Alabama, was going to win. If that had happened, would have been a huge win for Steve Bannon, a huge loss for Donald Trump. Steve would have had the leverage to go into 2018. He would be the one commanding the base. And he was going to use my book as a first step to break with the president, who he, had really come to believe was an idiot.
I want to ask you a Canada question, because we always like to talk about ourselves. There is a couple mentions of our prime minister in there, and one of them is around when Justin Trudeau goes down to meet him, and you say in the book that he sort of bites his tongue, and that's how they end up getting along. Is there a lesson in that?
I think that is the international lesson for all foreign leaders and diplomats. He just wants to be flattered, he wants to be praised, he wants what he wants. And if you give him what he wants, he will give you what you want, if it doesn't cost him anything.
So, lots of people thought he wouldn't last a year, they thought he wouldn't last the mandate. Where do you think, can he hold on to this for the next 3 years?
Good question. I don't know. I mean, anything could. There's a lot of minefields there. Probably the pivotal one is what happens in 2018.
Where does this leave sort of you and your view of the state of democracy in your country right now? And I know that's a big question, but knowing all you know.
To be perfectly honest, I kind of am optimistic. Trump went to Washington believing he could break everything. Washington and democracy itself is as much about institutions as it is about who gets elected. I don't think he can win against these institutions. I think that he believes he can disrupt everything, and he cannot.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wolff. Appreciate it very much.